Well, with me now is financial commentator Bernard Hickey from interest.co.nz. Bernard, thanks for coming in. A lot of ground to cover. First of all, John Key's comments pointing straight at Bernard, at his Alan Hubbard's the man to blame. Do you totally agree with that?
Yes, and he's not the only one. Sandy Meyer, the chief executive of South Canterbury Finance, came out today on our site and said that the blame for the problems with the loans lies squarely with Alan Hubbard. That he was in charge, he allowed lax governance and poor lending through that period. In fact, Sandy Meyer described South Canterbury Finance as a rotten fish, and that rotten fish start smelling from the head. And Alan Hubbard is the head of South Canterbury Finance.
It's kind of mind-bending to think an 80-something-year-old man who does everything on paper with pens and so forth is in charge of all this money, all these lives, and there's no advisors' safety nets along the way to sort of say, hey, maybe this isn't a great idea.
Well, he was immensely confident in his own abilities. He had auditors who were essentially in the office next door. He was trusted by everyone in South Canterbury. In fact, everyone in the South Island saw him as a type of investing god. Yet he was able to continue on without too much interference or governance help for more than a couple of decades. And as we've seen, he went too far. He didn't have the sorts of controls he needed, and now he's under investigation by the Serious Fraud Office, with good reason.
The government now saying that it's likely that they will look at perhaps getting money from offshore, selling offshore. How likely is that? How well is that likely to go down in the rural community?
If it happens. Remember, these are the bidders who were essentially unsuccessful in the last few days before the receivership. There are some assets that the government may look to sell. They include a Scales Corporation, New Zealand's largest apple grower and packager, Helicopters NZ, HNZ, which is New Zealand's biggest helicopters company, and a third of Dairy Holdings, the largest dairy farming operation in New Zealand. They, in theory, could be attractive to overseas buyers. But, of course, the government itself is looking at the Overseas Investment Act and whether foreigners should be allowed to buy farmland. So there may be some complications there for the government. And politically, it will be quite sensitive, particularly around the area of dairying,
which we've already run into in a more direct way earlier this year with the Chinese attempt to buy in as well. So that would seem kind of unlikely.
That's right. And the question is, will the government push ahead and look to sell these assets overseas and get the best price, or does it decide politically that it's too sensitive to sell it to overseas investors and accept a lower price? Essentially, this is the issue for New Zealand farming and the economy. We've pumped up the value of land, particularly dairy land and some residential land, higher than it's really worth. And if we were to block foreigners from buying it, we should allow those land values to subside.
OK, the investment guarantee side of the story, which is proving a fascinating thing all on its own. First of all, they must have known this company was in trouble when they first put these guarantees on. It was enough due diligence done to check South Canterbury Finance out before they said, right, we'll provide you with a safety net.
There are real questions about the carte blanche way that the deposit guarantee was given to just about everyone who applied for it in those crazy months, October, November of 2008. And certainly in April, when the guarantee was extended to South Canterbury Finance, that was another trigger point where the government said enough is enough. We now know that the government was sufficiently concerned about South Canterbury Finance as recently as the middle of last year that they put Corda Mentha, a professional receivership specialist, into South Canterbury to manage things. They no doubt were well aware and approved of the injection of Sandy Meyer into South Canterbury and the stripping of Alan Hubbard's ability to run that company. I'm actually quite surprised to see your footage there tonight to see that Alan Hubbard is still going to work there.
I wouldn't have thought he'd be allowed to.
That's very surprising given that the statutory manager is in control of his assets at South Canterbury, and that he, in theory, has no longer any involvement with South Canterbury.
Now, back to the investment guarantee side of things. Is it sending out the right message now to a company that got in all this trouble? Righto, here's your $1.6 billion. Boom, you're done. Any other company that is under this investment guarantee scheme at the moment is going to think, oh, we're struggling a bit, but the government's going to be there to back us up. Is that a risk?
Well, that's an issue for the trustees in particular. They're the ones who face liability if they don't pull the trigger before the end of the government guarantee. There is some time. The current extended guarantee goes until the end of next year. And many of the other companies involved, all of which are much smaller than South Canterbury Finance, are in different situations. They're catering to different markets. They didn't go ballistic in the property development sector, or they have significant funding of their own to support them. So we don't see the same risk of imminent collapse with other finance companies, or the taxpayer having to bail out even more of them. But certainly there are real questions about whether the scheme should have been extended in April to the rest, and really whether the finance company should be included to start with in October.
Just finally, the interest side of it. OK, they've got back their initial investment. They've also got, what was it, 8.5% return on it. How can they justify that? If you lose, you get your investment back, fine. Not the interest as well, surely.
Well, that was the terms of the scheme that the government set up in October and November to keep investor confidence in those extremely nervous few months around the time of the Lehman Brothers collapse. The government decided that it was a good idea to make sure that people believed they were going to get their interest back as well. And once you've signed up to the scheme, once the government's made the promise, it needs to deliver on that promise, as hard as it is for taxpayers and for those who have not are not at all eligible for the scheme. A lot of preference shareholders in South Canterbury are the ones who missed out here. They're not going to be repaid.
All right, from interest.co.nz, Bernard Hickey, thank you again.